Good evening, everyone. Thank you for coming out on this warm, balmy night. We're very excited for you to join us. My name is Maria Higgy, and I'm President and CEO of United Way of Greater Stark County. And on behalf of our Board of Directors, our volunteers, and our Women's Leadership Council, we want to welcome you to a very exciting event this evening. At United Way, it's our mission to energize and mobilize the community to care for each other by addressing needs in three building block areas: education, income, and health. And we do that by funding programs and events and initiatives that move the needle and affect change in the community in those three building blocks. And tonight is a great example of the work that's done in the area of education and mentoring. We're involved in many programs throughout Greater Stark County, programs like the Early Initiative Spark program to make sure kids are ready to enter school and ready to learn and pass the third grade test, care teams to make sure kids and families have the supports they need to be successful and move on to successfully graduate from school onto higher education or a trade of some form. We also work with Get Connected, and you're going to hear more about that, a very exciting initiative where we work with local companies to match them with youth in our community for job opportunities and training. We do a lot of great things in this community, and we do it with your support, so we thank you for coming tonight and for supporting your United Way. What's really great about the programs like you're going to see tonight is they're programs that work together to make sure students reach their fullest potential and, more importantly, have a bright, solid future ahead of them. So I thank you for being part of this special evening, and to make this tonight and tomorrow's event successful, we had sponsors that helped us put this together, and I want to take a moment to identify and recognize those individuals who made tonight so special. With us is the Canton Regional Chamber of Commerce, Junior Achievement of East Central Ohio, Malone University, Altman and Altman College, Canton City Schools, and McKinley Grand Hotel. Please join me in welcoming these sponsors and thanking them. In your program tonight, you noticed that tonight is a celebration of our Women's Leadership Council, who is celebrating their 10th anniversary. And with us tonight, we have past chairmen of our Women's Leadership Council, and I'd like to recognize them. Our first chairman 10 years ago was Sheila Markley Black, was also Donna Demmerling. Following Donna was Connie Alton, and following Connie was Eileen Weil. They are with us tonight. Ladies, please stand and be recognized. So I want to thank them for their vision to help us get to where we are tonight. And now it is my great pleasure to introduce to you our current chair of our Women's Leadership Council. And those of you who have had the opportunity to work with Lori Moline know she is a house of fire. And she is passionate, and she is visionary, and this was her dream. So I am so proud and so honored to introduce to you Lori Moline, United Way board member and chair of the United Way Women's Leadership Council. Lori?
Thank you. Thanks, Maria. It's really amazing to look out here and see more than 500, 600 people in attendance tonight for this event. It was November of last year when Lisa Fenn and I first began communicating about the potential for this presentation. But for me, this story really began back in 2002. I was a freelance producer assigned to tell the story of a young boy from Akron, a victim of a very traumatic accident. When I scheduled the interview, all I had was an address. And my MapQuest directions led me into a world very different than the one that I knew, and one that really made a lasting imprint on me. I was just one of many people that flashed in and out of this boy's life until 2008, when he met a brother, a best friend. And then in 2009, someone else came into their lives and never left. This is their story.
I'm Tom Rinaldi in Cleveland, Ohio, to tell you a story that started nearly 4 years ago. It's a story I thought was over after we initially broadcast it back in the summer of 2009. I was partially right. For me, it was over. But for the woman who produced it, Lisa Fenn, and the two young men we profiled, Leroy Sutton and Dartanyon Crockett, the story was just beginning of three people who entered each other's lives and never left.
In our job, we're always on the lookout for stories that are inspiring in nature. For people who have overcome something. Just looking at the two of them, you knew they overcame something. It was a startling image, one of those things that you want to look at, to absorb, yet you feel like you probably shouldn't be staring.
Notice your mess, right?
Saw me. Saw me.
They were inseparable. You could tell there was a brotherhood there.
Everything in life, he takes it all in stride. When we first met, we instantly had this bond. I just know I can count on him, just for anything.
He has his struggles, I have mine. We had our struggles, we're still going through them.
8 years before we met Leroy Sutton, his future was shaped on a set of train tracks while walking to school in Akron, Ohio.
There was rocks and gravel, and I kind of just slipped and just kind of just went under.
His backpack caught by one of the passing cars, Leroy was pulled beneath a slow-moving freight train. Both his legs were crushed.
I just asked why. That's all I did the whole time I was in the hospital, just ask why. Why? When I tried to go to sleep, I'd end up hearing the sound of a train, and it just woke me back up.
By the time we met Leroy in Cleveland, he'd already been living as a double amputee for 8 years.
The day we went to film at Leroy's house and watched how he gets up the stairs to his grandmother's house and how he lifts that wheelchair over his head. Took my breath away.
Leroy agreed to spend some time with Lisa and our film crew, reluctantly.
I found Leroy in his room in the basement, and he was playing video games. I sat down and made a few attempts at conversation that went absolutely nowhere.
I have a real big issue with trust. So when she first showed up, I didn't want anything to do with her at all.
Leroy's been hurt a lot by people closest to him. It's just harder for him to actually build up that trust, to actually open up and trust someone.
Coming from a broken home, one of the only people Leroy did trust was Dartanyon Crockett, the only teammate strong enough to practice with Leroy on their high school wrestling team.
Get up, get on my back.
Jump on.
In fact, Dartanyon carried Leroy that entire season long, into and out of every match.
He was able to come to school every day with a smile on his face. You would never think that anything was wrong with him.
Leroy was only half the story and half the reason we came to Cleveland. Dartanyon had a challenge of his own, as I learned when I first interviewed him. How would you describe your ability to see?
From where I'm sitting, I can just barely make out your facial features.
How far away am I from you?
4 or 5 feet, something like that.
Dartanyon is legally blind. Born with Leber's disease, a condition that causes acute visual loss, D'Artagnan's been severely nearsighted his entire life.
I planned to meet D'Artagnan outside of the school office, and as he was about 15 feet away from me, he said, "Hey, Lisa, how are you?" And I said, "How did you see me?" And he said, "I just remember that's the way your shadow stands."
So back then we thought we had our story. It was clear. The wrestler who couldn't walk, carried by the one who couldn't see. But there was much more that we, especially Lisa, were beginning to glimpse. For D'Artagnan, we found out his mother, Juanita, died when he was just 8 years old. His father, Arthur, battled drug and alcohol addiction. And for much of D'Artagnan's youth, we learned he had no permanent place to call home.
There have been times that I'd have to, like, just scavenge the house for food because we have so little. I've moved about 5 or 6 times within the past 3 years. Some cases because, like, we didn't have the money.
D'Artagnan found his stability and his strength on the wrestling mat.
When I started, it gave me structure, gave me responsibility, it gave me a family, gave me brothers that I didn't get a chance to grow up with because we were separated when my mother had passed. After I win a match, and I look to the ceiling and point, all that is dedicated to my mother.
Despite their disabilities, D'Artagnan finished the 2009 wrestling season 26-3 and was a league champion. Leroy won 9 matches, a majority of those by pin. But as much as the two were bound by their sport, they were drawn closer by their friendship. Almost everywhere we found one, we found the other. Brothers more than wrestlers.
I really admired how they stayed on the straight path. They didn't make destructive choices. They weren't bitter. They had just been dealt a really lousy hand.
I present to you Lincoln West High School Class of 2009 graduates.
As that school year closed, both had earned his diploma from a high school with a graduation rate under 50%.
Both of them just seemed like they had come the farthest of anyone standing on that stage to get that diploma.
Good job, man. Good job, man. What did I think that the future would be? I honestly had no idea. Had no idea where I would end up.
Thought my future would just be like, you know, get a job at either GameStop, Walmart. Coming from where I come from, there's not really too much of a future in that neighborhood.
After they crossed this stage, D'Artagnan and Leroy essentially walked away from structure and into uncertainty. Wrestling was over, school was done, our cameras were gone. One thing they did know was their story would be broadcast across the country that summer, and it was in August 2009.
For Outside the Lines, Tom Rinaldi reports on one such friendship.
The story ended with a simple fact that while both wanted to attend college, neither could afford it. That fact struck a chord with our viewers and sparked an incredible response.
For the next 5 or 6 hours, I averaged an email about every 2 minutes. Most of the emails were from people who wanted to know how they could give money. I didn't really know what they could do. But I have a family friend who's an attorney and in warp speed helped to set up a trust fund.
In all, Lisa received over 700 emails from viewers offering to help. And in less than a month, nearly $50,000 was contributed to the Carry On Trust. And a small number of donors did even more, stepping forward to pay the balance of college tuition and living expenses for both Leroy and D'Artagnan.
What a great feeling to be able to deliver news like that to people that there's hope.
The possibility of college was closer, but still far from reach. Simply put,
Dartanyon and Leroy had no idea or help how to move beyond the only world they'd ever known, inner city Cleveland. That's when Lisa stepped in and became the living difference. In short, she did everything, from collecting their transcripts, to helping them apply to college, to managing their finances. The TV story was over. In the next year, Lisa would leave her producing job altogether, but in Dartanyon and Leroy's life, she was just beginning.
She had a tremendous amount of responsibility that she put on herself as she took on this role, and the incredible needs that they had, countless hours spent, and very taxing, because if she wasn't able to do this, these two young men would not have the means to continue on.
You can't go into environments like this and earn the trust of two boys like this who have needs like this and then just walk away. I mean, I don't think anyone would do that, really. I'm not going to be next on that list of people to break their trust.
She cared enough to stay and help us out through something that was as critical as this.
We just formed a bond, and she just really wanted to help, really wanted to see us succeed. She thought that we struggled enough.
I'm all right.
Dartanyon,
what's
your name?
Leroy.
With Lisa's help, another opportunity emerged. Leroy and Dartanyon were invited to visit the United States Olympic Training Center in Colorado. The trip changed D'Artagnan's life. In February 2010, he moved to Colorado full-time in the hopes of becoming a U.S. Paralympian in a new sport, judo.
When I first got out here, pretty much just had just the basic room, the bed, desk, you know, pretty much just the bare essentials. But for me, it was the best thing I've ever had.
Leroy's focus shifted to becoming a full-time college student, far from the Ohio winter.
I ended up going to Collins College in Phoenix, Arizona, to study video game design.
Keep up the good work.
Thank you.
Leroy is on track to earn his bachelor's degree this August, but it hasn't been easy.
Right around the time that Leroy was going off to college, he told us that his girlfriend was pregnant and he was going to be a father. And I thought, it's over.
On December 20th, 2010, Alani Sutton was born.
He was determined to be the father that he didn't have.
That's my goal, like, not to be one of those dads to just, like, get up and disappear. That she would never have to live through anything that I lived through.
This is the story of how Winnie the Pooh and his friends and honey.
What I've learned from Leroy is you can never ever count him out. He was hit by a train. And he got up. What more do you need to know?
While Leroy faced the challenges of new fatherhood head on, Dartanyon tackled his new path with determination. After just 2 years practicing to master his new sport, judo, he was trying to earn a spot in the 2012 Paralympic Games in London. To get there, he'd have to win his weight division at the national trials.
Hey, let's not get into a swing contest. You know what you want to do. Straight back drag, you're letting him do that to you. Yeah, come on, keep going. Yeah!
You're not careful, he'll hurt you. I work out with him.
Yeah, keep moving. Don't stop moving. Yes, sir!
Let's just keep doing it like that, sir. Okay.
Turn it, turn it! Yeah!
One more. Okay, stick to the plan. Give me some. Let's go.
After 5 wins in 1 day, Dartanyon stood at the edge of his goal. One more win, and he'd be going to London for the Paralympic Games.
Go! Yep! Yeah! Woo!
Congratulations. Hey, I got somebody I need you to talk to.
Lisa.
Hey, Lisa. I'm going to London. I'm going to London.
It was important to me that the first person I spoke to was Lisa because she got me there.
I love you too.
Once again, they always teach me you can never, ever count them out. Ever.
All throughout high school, I supported him. I'd stay by the mats, and it's like, now he's going to the Paralympics. And it's like, I want to be there for that. I want to be there to support him, like old times.
It just wouldn't make sense without Leroy. How could he not be there for the biggest competition of his life?
You did it!
Yes, I didn't miss my flight.
All right. Go get him.
Oh, I'm excited. He has no idea I'm coming.
I was trying so hard not to laugh. I'm just like sneaking up behind him.
We take a home gold? We take a home gold? What's up, baby?
Dartanyon was the only judo athlete there without a parent. So you could tell he was tense. But then when Leroy arrived, everything changed.
We have that bond, and that bond is damn near unbreakable.
Reaching London was great, but D'Artagnan's goal was greater, to earn a medal. A loss to Samuel Ingram of Great Britain was tough, but not final. D'Artagnan still had the chance to earn bronze if he could win his next two matches.
That's what I'm talking about there!
I did it, Lisa.
You did it. You did everything.
I'm so proud of you. So proud of you.
You were amazing. Absolutely amazing.
Just being on the medal stand and have them put the medal around your neck. It's just, it's incredible.
This is Dartanyon, the dude that I met in high school and wrestled with and created this bond and became brothers with. He just bronzed.
We've formed a special family through this process. I can't really imagine life without them.
She is the largest support that I've ever had. She took an inner city kid and made him into a Paralympic champion.
She's like another mother. Me and Dartanyon were brothers. We're brothers. And she just created the family. Like she was the missing piece to the family.
All right, let's do this for real this time. Please welcome Lisa Fenn. Such a warm welcome, and I'm so glad that we sorted out the video, because that ending would have been really hard for me to just stand up here and explain, wouldn't it? I cry every time, and I know how it ends. Well, thank you for such a warm greeting, but we're going to have to be honest with ourselves. I'm not who you're most excited to see tonight, I have a feeling. So why don't you help me welcome to the stage Mr. Dartanyon Crockett and Leroy Sutton. Of my life, and you'll be hearing plenty more from them as well. We want to thank you for this warm welcome and this gracious homecoming. It feels so good to be back in Ohio. All three of us are natives of Cleveland, and Leroy spent significant time in Akron as well. So this is home to us, and we thank you for welcoming us home. And we thank you for braving the cold and coming out on this blustery evening to support mentoring relationships. It's a cause very dear to our hearts. I became a mentor through a most unusual backdoor route. For 13 years, I worked at ESPN as a producer, which most simply put is a storyteller. I traveled the world chronicling human interest stories against the backdrop of sports. I covered Derek Jeter and Michael Jordan, along with disabled amateurs and terminally ill little leaguers, all who imprinted their own special brand of heroics on this world. And what a privilege it was to be invited into their private celebrations and their sacred pains. But what I found on the wrestling mats at Lincoln West High School caused my heart to both sink and soar all in the same moment. As you just saw, it was a story so compelling that after I reported it, I became a part of it. And in doing so, I inadvertently became a mentor. And I did so with many of the same questions that many of you probably brought with you tonight. Questions such as, is it ever too late for a child to turn their life around? Has life ever taken so much of a toll that the effects are irreversible? What if getting involved is complicated, or time-consuming, or a little messy? Is it ever okay to walk away? Or can love really conquer all? As Leroy, Dartanyon, and I have gotten to know each other better over these last 5 years, we've learned some surprising answers. And they're answers that we hope bring clarity to you as you navigate your own mentoring relationships. I've asked Dartanyon and Leroy to start tonight by telling you a little bit more about their childhoods, which most would characterize as defining and limiting
and they began unraveling long before I met them.
When I was at the age of... Stop it. When I was about 8 years old, my life pretty much had to reset. It had to start all over. It started all over. At the time, my mother, Juanita, was my cornerstone. She was my rock. She was everything to me in this world. I was the sixth of seven children, and I was her baby boy. Yes, I was the baby's boy, I was mama's boy, and I am proud of it. So what? You don't know my life. By around the time she, after giving birth to my youngest sister Danielle, she had died of a brain aneurysm. My father, he was the one who had told me. He told me after school one time, I'd come into the living room and he said, "Dar, sit down. Something to tell you. Your mother's dead." I didn't hear any emotion in his voice, not a hint of sympathy, no compassion whatsoever. I want to ask you, what do you do when you pretty much lose everything, everything that mattered to you in this world, everything that brought you happiness, that brought you joy? What do you do when you lose that? What happens next? My heart sank, my throat tightened, my hands started to tremble. Sadness and anger consumed me. My spirit was completely crushed. I wanted to cry my eyes out, but tears wouldn't come. I wanted everything to be just this nightmare. But right after the nightmare that I had just fallen into had become my reality, and I could not escape it. Soon after, I went to live with my father, because the rest of my brothers and sisters, we were separated because we had different fathers. So then when they lived with their dads, I went and lived with mine. For a while, it was just me and him until we couldn't afford rent, and then we moved into the downstairs apartment with my uncle. We got new neighbors that moved upstairs, and that's when our house became a trap house, or a crack house, a house that sells and distributes drugs to the rest of the neighborhood. And that's when I realized that my father was a customer. He was an addict. Not only a drug addict, he was also an alcoholic. And once I noticed this, his addictions, his symptoms began to go from bad to worse. Because either he was never home and the house was empty because he was out feeding his addiction. And it was usually, the house was usually pretty empty with food as well. Me and my uncle never got along, so I was alone for pretty much all of it. I really started to miss my family. I started to miss my brothers and sisters. I missed my mother the most. I missed having warm meals at night. I missed having a home in my own room where I felt safe. The area I lived in wasn't safe. I never really went outside, didn't have any friends because it was just... there was no point to it, so I just stayed home. It was quiet, it was lonely, it was empty. It's an empty, numb feeling. And after a while, I started to embrace it. I embraced the silence, the loneliness, the emptiness, and I clung to it. Clung to it like a dear friend. At the time, for me, it was the only friend I had.
I was raised in both Cleveland and Akron. My mom was an addict, and throughout most of her time as an addict, she would sell also to support her own habit. We were always moving. I went through 10 schools in 12 years. That's a lot. When she was home, she was always angry, she was always yelling, and from time to time she would disappear for weeks and leave my brother, my little sister, and I alone for weeks. And me and my brother would switch off, going
on who would go to school and who would stay home to look after my little sister. And most of the time it was me, because I just didn't feel like getting up and going. But when I did go to school, I had to go like a nutcase. I was just goofy all the time and, you know, joking around with everybody. I always had a smile on my face. Was known for having the biggest smile, actually. And it was actually a facade. I was actually hurting. I was actually angry. I was sad. You know, I was in a house with just my brother and sister. My mom didn't care. My dad left when I was 3, so, you know, it was a huge facade. Nobody had to feel bad or, you know, have to worry about me. My brother would sell drugs to support the house, to keep food in the house, keep the lights on, the heat, because it happened a lot during, like, the winter and whatnot. So I had him sell my prescription drugs because I didn't take them anyways. I never liked taking pills. I've done some recreational activity in that field. You know, it was what was modeled for me. So I drank, and in middle school I started drinking other recreational things. And we threw parties every weekend because there was nothing else to do. And it was fun. But otherwise, you know, it was all unsupervised. It was just, you know, what we had to do. Kids from school or whatever will stop by, from the high school mostly. I've done a lot more in my life than people who are twice my age. And, you know, that's saying a lot. I'm one who's quick to wear a mask. I'll smile and make it seem like I'm happy or whatnot. Now I don't do it. Now I'm happy. I promise. I did a lot of things I'm not proud of. Done a lot of things I'm not proud of. I was known as the black sheep in my family. And to this day, I still think that. It's been hard for me.
While Leroy's and D'Artagnan's stories are certainly unique, they're sadly not uncommon. There's more and more students showing up at your local school's front steps seeking refuge from their own shelter. They live in fear of what is inside their front door, and they live in fear of what is outside their front door. Leroy and D'Artagnan wrestled with how to pull themselves up into a better life. They were told that education was the ticket, and so they went to Lincoln West High School every day and hoped that it was true. What they found there, unfortunately, was sometimes just as disappointing as what they were finding at home. Overcrowded classes, discouraged teachers, a different overwhelmed principal at the helm each year. There were arrests in the halls and gangs in the streets. It was a discouraging place at times for them. Certainly there were teachers there who did care, and they treasure those teachers, but largely they were discouraged. What they did find at Lincoln West High School, though, was each other. And that's a special thing. And I've asked them to tell you a little bit more now about how they met each other and what that relationship meant to them. Leroy, why don't you start?
So, D'Artagnan's name in high school was Muscles. I was introduced to him by a friend who was also on the wrestling team. His name was Steven. And D'Artagnan was at lunch, and, you know, we'd just skip out of class anyways and just lightly gag over there, and we ended up running into D'Artagnan. He's like, "All right, Leroy, this is Muscles. Muscles, this is Leroy."
And I had two thoughts at that moment.
Two thoughts.
One, you're not the only dude here with muscles anymore. Two, I think he gave himself that name. And that was my junior year at Lincoln West. I had just moved there with my grandmother. And, you know, I didn't talk to him much that year. I couldn't wrestle. My grandmother just had heart surgery, so I was at home taking care of her. So we didn't talk much that year besides a what's up in the hallway, you know, peace sign here and head not there. Then the year after is when we had class together. One of our coaches, he's actually in the crowd somewhere in there. His name is Coach Hans, Justin Hans.
Hansi Poo.
But we had his class together, and we'd get in trouble actually a lot. I want to tell the story so bad. Okay, I'm going to tell the story. So there was a cookie drive, and it was wrestling season, and we weren't supposed to have cookies or any sweets or anything like that. And Dartanyon decides, hey, I'm going to buy some cookies. Don't tell Coach Hans. And then we had his class right after he bought those cookies. And he's sitting in the back. We sat in the back, and he's sitting there just munching on these cookies. And Coach talking about something up there. I forgot what it was because I was sitting there laughing at him. And he's like, isn't that right, Dartanyon? Dartanyon just looks up, and he's like, yes. Mouthful of cookies. It was so hilarious. But yeah, that's the story. I'm going to let Dartanyon go on.
He's going to put me on the spot like that. That's cool. Whatever. I thought you were my boy. So then Leroy came out for the wrestling team. It was... Everyone was kind of skeptical because we weren't sure how a legless guy would do on the wrestling team. You don't see that in the inner city, really. You rarely see that anywhere. Guy with no legs, I want to wrestle. Okay, whatever. So I was the captain at the time, and I'd said, I'll wrestle him. And that's when I figured out that this dude is stupid amounts of strong. It's ridiculous. This guy is so strong. And so then our first wrestling meet, we had a bus that was not wheelchair accessible. And there was no huge panic or anything. No one, like, went crazy, like, oh, my God, what are we going to do with the legless dude? No, yeah. We addressed the situation. We broke down his wheelchair. And I was like, I'll just put him on back, and we'll carry him on a bus. And it kind of became an ongoing thing. It wasn't all, no dramatic, you know, scenario where I was just like, I'll take the boy. Sorry. And then it kind of became this ongoing thing because and I didn't have a problem with carrying them, and it was just easier that way, especially when we didn't have a bus that was wheelchair accessible, or if we got to a school and then there was no ramp or no elevator. And even when it came to the gyms, our team always sat at the top of the bleachers because we're number one. We sit at the top, it's everybody beneath us.
That's true.
Right? So I'd carry him up to the top too because it's pretty hectic trying to navigate bleachers with no legs. After a while, we came to trust each other because when someone's carrying you for, you know, all the time, then you have to trust them to an extent. At least to not drop you, or you hope so anyway. And as this year progressed, Leroy became more than just a teammate, more than just a friend. He became a brother to me, something that I was really longing for because I didn't get a chance to grow up with my brothers because we were separated. They went to live with their fathers, I went to live with mine. And Leroy was just someone who I really wanted to be around because this dude's like a freaking bonfire just rolling through, spreading warmth everywhere. Just a rolling bonfire, that's what he is. And I wanted to be around that. My team, actually, the team itself just gave me a sense of structure, a sense of belonging, brotherhood. And I was so happy to just even have a small piece of that. And it was through wrestling that I saw that I had a talent, that I saw something that I didn't know was there, that I didn't believe was there at the time. Because most of my life, I was on the losing end of a battle. I was on the losing end of a battle that I'm sure a lot of people have been there. You can't win. But when I was on the mats, when I stepped on the mats, I could win. I did win. And felt a great sense of achievement and triumph every time I walked off the mat.
So how did I meet these two goofy treasures, you might be wondering. Well, it was a cold February morning in 2009. My phone rang early, and it was my father in Cleveland. An avid sports fan, he was always on the hunt for my next great feature story idea. And on this particular morning, he alerted me to a photo in the Cleveland newspaper, which looked similar to this one. Leroy Sutton riding on the back of Dartanyon Crockett. I've seen a lot of things in my 10 years of feature producing, but I had never seen a photo like that before. So I hightailed it into my ESPN offices in Bristol, Connecticut, and I cornered my manager, Victor, and I said, Victor, if we are going to do this story, we have to do it right now because the last wrestling match of their careers starts in 5 hours in Ohio. They were wrestling in sectionals that day, and if they didn't advance, they were done. He wasn't impressed with my urgency. He said, well, what exactly is the story? And I said, well, the one standing is blind, and the one on his back was hit by a train when he was 11. And he said, well, that's nice. What are they, good wrestlers? And I said, probably not. It's City League, and one has no legs. He said, are they articulate? I said, I've never spoken to them. He said, are they friends? I said, kind of looks like it, huh? Don't really carry around acquaintances on your back. And he was growing impatient. He said, Lisa, while being blind and being hit by a train 7 years ago is certainly tragic, it's not exactly current news. And I said, I know, but you have to admit you've never seen a photo like that before. There must be something more. But you see, when we're getting approval for story ideas, we go through several rounds of discussion with our managers. We do pre-interviews with subjects. We do extensive background research. And on that morning, I had done nothing. But rather than send me back to my desk, Victor rolled the dice. And he said, what's your gut feeling? And I said, it's good. And then he uttered the words that would forever change three lives. Have a nice trip to Cleveland. 5 hours later, I entered Mid Park High School in Brook Park, Ohio, the site of their Greater Cleveland sectional wrestling matches. And there they were, coming right at me, Leroy on the back of D'Artagnan. Now, I can make conversation with professional athletes with relative ease, but knowing what to say to them shook my nerves a little bit. Before I could figure it out, though, their coach noticed my camera crew, and he jumped over. I extended my hand to introduce myself, and he playfully slapped it away, and he said, you have been sent here by God. No pressure there, huh? Yikes! He went on to explain that every day he walked the indoor track at their gym, and he prayed for his wrestlers, and he said, this year I've been praying hard for Crockett and Sutton, because he said, they're seniors, and when they graduate, this world's got nothing for them. And then ESPN walks into my gym, he said. He said, that ain't no coincidence. You are here for a reason. Well, I wasn't so convinced. I went up the bleachers to introduce myself to them. D'Artagnan was all smiles and chatty and eager to be on SportsCenter. But Leroy was a little tougher. Every time I got near, he put his headphones on and his head down. He wanted nothing to do with me. The next week, I returned to Cleveland in hopes of getting to know them better. I followed them through their classes and practices, and still not a glance from Leroy. I took the risk of visiting him at his grandmother's house. Not working. And for four nights, For four nights, we sat together in his grandmother's basement. We sat together in his grandmother's basement for four nights in silence. I sat beside him, watching him play video games. The slaying of demons and dragons, a symbolic sort of therapy for him. Now, the last video game that I touched was Frogger in the late 80s when my Atari 5200 was under the Christmas tree one year. So I couldn't even fake a conversation with him, and I didn't try. But on the fourth night, I finally broke the silence, and I spoke. And I said, Leroy, I want to thank you for allowing me to sit here with you these last four nights. It's been an honor. I can tell it's not a comfortable place for you, so I won't be back tomorrow. I think that somewhere deep inside you, you have a special story to share. And if you decide you want to do that for television, I'm here to help you do that in the most meaningful way possible. But if you don't, and you think you might like a friend instead, I'm even more interested in that.
She tricked me.
I started up the stairs, and soon after I heard him coming up behind me and he said, hey, hey. I turned around. He said, I got a new game, you want to see it? And I knew I was in. What I didn't know was just how much I was in for, though. Leroy and Dartanyon released the deeper details of their home lives cautiously, testing what I could handle and if I would leave. They had never had a safe space in which to share their story. They had never had a safe person to whom to share their story with. And as the weeks turned into months of filming, both boys began to believe that perhaps I genuinely cared. And I did care. I was rooting for them. But the deck was stacked pretty high. They're poor, they're black, and they're disabled. In the eyes of a lot of people, that's three strikes and you're out. Yet as I filmed in their classes, I noticed something curious at the top of D'Artagnan's paper. He would doodle the phrase, destined for greatness. And it stopped me in my tracks. I thought, well, he is blind. Maybe he can't see that that's just not possible in a place like this. But you see, D'Artagnan was sending a message. He had wrapped a cast around his broken heart, and he signed it himself. He signed it, you are wrong. There can be more to me. Well, when our first feature aired in 2009 on ESPN, America agreed. From Ipswich to Idaho, men and women, young and old, saw what D'Artagnan saw, the potential for greatness. The supporters rallied around, the funds rolled in, and college was now a reality. And I truly thought that I would pack them up and wave proudly from afar as they rode off into their new lives. But it quickly became apparent that the landmines between their reality and their dreams were more than they could navigate alone. We call these things ghetto grenades.
Kapuya.
Wow.
They were things like when Leroy needed a bank check for his college housing deposit, but he didn't know a soul with money in the bank. Or D'Artagnan, despite graduating high school, emerged with a fifth grade math level and an eighth grade reading level. Neither one of them could hold on to a dollar, hit a deadline, pay a bill, or organize a day. They had all of the heart and soul of survivors and champions, but the life skills of children. And so every time they would make a mistake or drop a ball, people in my life would look at our struggles and they would say, how ungrateful are these two to waste these opportunities? How lazy can they be? How stupid are they? And I would fire back and I'd say, you know, I have a hunch they're not ungrateful, and they're not lazy, and they're not stupid. I think they are who you become when you grow up in an unstable home. I think they're who you become when you grow up without a support system. Because what I was seeing in their neighborhoods and in their families was that being poor and being homeless had less to do with running out of money and everything to do with that running out of useful relationships. You cannot break out of poverty with determination alone. It takes a hand, and not a handout, but a hand up to a level playing field. I also started to see that giving them opportunities was only half of the solution, and only half of what they needed. The other half, the crucial half, the exciting half, was love. Because opportunities have a real hard time getting off the ground without a little love in the gas tank, don't they? Leroy and D'Artagnan, if they were going to thrive, they needed a constant support who would be with them through the two steps forward and every step back. And so when things grew difficult, I resolved to love harder. And as a result, they tried harder. And in the rare times that they didn't, I just dragged them along until the taste of success was sweet enough in their mouths that they craved it for themselves. I clung tightly to the slightest grade improvement, a deadline hit, a month without overdrafting, and with every victory, I poured on the praise because I knew that though being a Sutton or being a Crockett might look like a curse to an outsider, it's not. It's simply a pattern, and a committed love could break that cycle. This was evidenced to me last summer when Leroy texted me a video of a rainstorm in Phoenix, where he lives. And that's a rarity. They don't get a lot of rain in the desert. And I'm going to wait for this next graphic because I promise it's worth it. His accompanying message with the video of the rainstorm read, quote, "All of this love has created an imbalance in the universe." As you heard, this was a boy who had largely given up on humanity, and for very good reason. But to me, those were the words of a heart that was beginning to heal. It was possible. On the surface, there is virtually nothing about Leroy, D'Artagnan, and I that go together, is there? No one would have blamed us for walking away from each other. We had every excuse in the world for why we couldn't connect. I am white, they are black. I was upper class, they were lower class. I'm Ivy League, they're urban educated. I'm physically whole, they have challenges. We had every excuse, never mind even the 15-year culture and age gap. We had every excuse for why we couldn't connect. But instead, we decided to forge community in one another. When we found that our whole was greater, more powerful than the sum of our very different parts. And more importantly, we became a family. We found that the love was greater than our differences. And it was that hope and love that seeped through the knotted messes of Leroy's and D'Artagnan's past and helped them to actualize their potentials. And we can all be on the front lines of administering that type of healing love, of communicating someone's potential to them so clearly that they're inspired to see it in themselves. As Leroy said, he passed through 10 schools in 12 years. It's a lot of schools. But today, he's the first person in his family with a high school diploma and now a college degree. Hold on. There we go. D'Artagnan is thriving in school, he's learning the saxophone, and he's a Paralympic medalist. Come on! There was a lot of potential in that rubble, and a lot of people, including myself at first, judged those books by the wrong cover. Today, D'Artagnan is studying social work because he hopes to help kids who grew up like himself. And Leroy, despite wrestling with the big why questions of his accident, will now tell you that he would much rather change this world than walk on it. And as for me, I learned that if you treat a man as he has the potential if you treat a man as he is, you leave him worse than he is. But if you treat a man as he has the potential to become, you can make him better than he is. And many of you are here tonight because you are considering embarking on such a mentoring relationship. Or maybe you're already in one and you just need some encouragement. Leroy and D'Artagnan, while I love them to death, I am not the only person who has come alongside them in these last 5 years to walk alongside them. There have been countless others who have been part of our cause and our family in large and small ways all of them equally valuable and equally meaningful. And so to encourage you further in your relationships, Leroy and Dartanyon are going to share with you now what it feels like to have people in their corner.
The main thing I want people to know and understand about poverty is that, which I'm sure many of you, if not all of you, know and understand, that it's not a choice. Except it's a circumstance that is placed on us, that we are born into, whether we like it or not. It's like being born into royalty. You're born into poverty. I want people to understand that people who are poor are hard workers. That they want a heart and they want to work hard and they want to succeed, but it's pretty much a genetic cycle that can't be broken alone. And money is not the answer. Money alone is not the answer. If Lisa would have come and given us all the money that was donated to the trust fund 4 years ago or 5 years ago, then me and Leroy, we'd still be poor. We'd still be in poverty because we would have spent all the money in a week on video games and bubble gum or something. It would be gone.
Danishes, man.
Danishes. We needed someone, instead of giving us just a handful of money and saying, here, we've done our part, to walk alongside us and help us forge these life goals that we didn't have as a kid. Help us learn how to balance a checkbook, how to write a check, how to even schedule a day. Because we could do none of these things like after graduating high school. And those are key factors. We knew about Romeo and Juliet, but didn't really know about balancing a checkbook. And I believe that Lisa is an angel sent from above. I thought this when I first met her, which reminded me of a really, really quick story. You've never heard it. And when you said something earlier, you made me think about it. It was wrestling sectionals. It's really when I found out that this woman had stolen my heart and she is love personified. I had lost one of my matches, a match that I was supposed to win, a guy who I beat every single time except for that day. I had lost bad. I was teched. For all you wrestlers who know, you know what that is. You know how bad that feels. I was teched. I was up at the bleachers, and I was crying like a blubbering idiot. Slaying back, hand over my eye. Lisa, instead of keeping the camera rolling on me and just kind of standing off in her corner waiting to interview me afterwards, like a reporter should, she knelt down next to me. She said, I know you're disappointed. I know you're hurt. I know you're frustrated. I know you're in pain, but I couldn't be any more proud of you, as if you were my own kid. I barely know your story, but the little that I do know, I love you and I'm proud of you. These words coming from a complete stranger sometimes could seem like they just fall off. But when I heard those words from her, I knew that they were love. And I know she meant every single word. And that she did love me with every beat of her heart. Yes, that's from a song. I know some of y'all know it. And another quick story. When I was applying for college back in Cleveland, Cuyahoga Community College, I was filling out the application for school, and I got down to the part where it says emergency contact. I would usually put my sister, but at this point, I don't think she had a phone. And I couldn't put anyone else in my family because no one could hold onto a phone for more than 2 weeks or the number would change. So there was no consistency there. So I didn't really know what to do. Now, my new white friend, Lisa. She cares a lot about me. I think she's great. But I didn't know what to put when it said relationship status. Well, what's your relationship to the person? Should I put friend? ESPN lady? Which was her famous nickname throughout high school. Sugar mama? No, none of that seemed right. None of those were the right answers. Then it came to me. The right answer came to me, and it was the right answer the entire time. Leroy and I were both just blind to it. No pun intended.
Pun intended.
This woman who had come into my life out of nowhere when I needed her most, whether I knew it or not, bent over backwards and forward to make everything right, to make everything the best she could, the feeling that we didn't have to struggle anymore. And it's our turn to have a taste of success. This woman is our guardian angel. She has been, and she will forever be our guardian angel. She is also really good at hiding her wings, because I've yet to see them. I've looked. They're there. I know they are. But that's who she is.
My mic kept rubbing up against my shirt. People don't always need assistance, but people can always use a friend. Being handed money, food, clothes, can seem like an empty gesture, even when necessary. Now it's humming. It's awesome. I never liked feeling like anybody's charity. It's always been me. The one thing that's been awesome about our journey is the people who've come into our lives just to pay for things end up becoming a part of our lives. They want to laugh with us. They wanted to cry with us. They want to be a part of our lives long term. This is bothering me. And I'm incredibly grateful to them. I now call them aunt, uncle, friend. Mostly they have family titles. I actually share a lot of my poetry with them. One of them, Uncle Bob, I made him cry with one of my poems. It was awesome. Lisa is no longer helping us. We are her children. She has two other ones, and we're the small ones. But we're her children. It's a relationship grounded on love and respect. Mm-hmm. And that's what people in poverty need. That's what got us out.
So as you see, all three of us took a big risk 5 years ago to let each other in to one another's life. But this is what happens when you open yourselves up to care about someone that the rest of the world says doesn't matter, to let yourself matter to them. What we've learned is that you can change the world when you enter into someone else's world, when you come alongside and help pick up the broken pieces and make something beautiful out of them. I used to believe that if you had enough determination and perseverance that you could overcome any circumstance, including poverty. But I now know that that's wrong. That's what I learned incorrectly from Hollywood movies. Leroy and Dartanyon were not stuck where they were because of a lack of determination or perseverance. They were stuck where they were because of a lack of useful, caring relationships in their lives. And the people that I've gotten to know in their families and in their neighborhoods are not necessarily poor because of a lack of money. They don't need more tax credits or food drives because honestly they don't know how to spend the rebate and they don't have a palate for bad canned food. What they need are people to come beside them through the two steps forward and every step back. They need all of you. They need me. They need them. They need us. Now, do those type of relationships take time? They can. Can they be complicated sometimes? Yeah. But are they worth it? Absolutely. And if you're sitting here tonight thinking about becoming a mentor and you're wondering if it's something you could truly do, I borrowed this illustration from Julie Foudy. She's an Olympic soccer player and she's an analyst at ESPN. And she says, over here in this little safe circle, that's your comfort zone. But over here, if you just step out, this is where the magic happens. This is your comfort zone. This is where the magic happens. You can change the world when you enter into another's world. In closing, I just want to say that I really believe that we're not going to get to the end of our lives and be asked about our net worth or how many titles and degrees we have after our name. I think we're going to be asked how we invested in people. I think we're going to find that we only get this one life, and we don't truly live it until we give it away. I want to thank you all tonight for your generous time and attention, for coming here, for thinking about how you can invest in other people's lives. I wish you every blessing as you go out and navigate those relationships, as you start to find your magic. Thank you.
So those are powerful words you heard, aren't they, from what Lisa said? Well, you know, if you were to see this presentation in any other city, we'd probably be saying goodnight and sending you on your way. But in Stark County, this story's had a stronger impact. Do you guys remember Lisa's line in the video where she says, "I'm not going to be the next one on that list of people to break their trust"? When I first saw this feature on ESPN in 2013, that line haunted me. Leroy was 12 when I first met him, and I only spent an hour or so with him. But I saw the neighborhood he lived in. I saw the things that were happening on the porch next door at 11 a.m. on a Thursday. I went into his house, which had no furniture, was littered with trash, and was no place for children. I also knew how many people came in and out of his life during the time surrounding that accident. People who were telling stories, taking pictures, winning awards for the pictures. Could I have done something more? Shouldn't somebody have done something more? So by the time this video first ran, the Women's Leadership Council had been partnering for many years with the Career Tech Program at Canton City Schools. And volunteering at Timken High School gave us an opportunity to start working with the students. Contrary to what Lisa found, we found something different here. We found teachers who cared. We found principals who cared. We found parents who cared, but sometimes needed some support and encouragement on their own. But most importantly, we saw potential. We saw a lot of potential in these kids. And we felt that if we could support the schools by helping students identify a pathway for their futures, and more importantly, help them build relationships with professionals in the community, it would be a step in the right direction for them. And that's how Get Connected was born in 2010 at Altman College of Nursing and Health Sciences. So the template was pretty simple. We'd actually invite high school students with an interest in healthcare into the college and give them an opportunity to do some hands-on activities. But really, what would set Get Connected apart or make it different than any other business tour or college visit is that the kids would get a chance to sit one-on-one with professionals to practice networking and begin learning how to share their story. We learned from each Get Connected that we had, and we started seeing some really good interactions occurring during these one-on-one conversations. And that's when we began to see the potential for mentoring. My first mentoring relationship started in 2012 with a young woman named Markel Jesse, a student in the Allied Health program at Timken High School. Markel came to Get Connected twice at Altman College, and we also knew her through another program we do called Girl Up. She's now a sophomore at Ohio State and is one of our panelists tonight. She interned with United Way the past two summers, and she was a major force this summer behind the coordination of this event, actually being the one that came up with the idea of having it here, which was perfect since this is really the place that we kind of started the whole Get Connected program. So please welcome our first panelist, Markel Jesse. So Markel taught me so much. I was constantly asking her questions, and we had many intense conversations, usually over food, about things that could help kids succeed and things that got in the way. In September of 2013, Diebold came on board as a Get Connected partner with the help of Women's Leadership Council Steering Committee member and Diebold executive Linda Parcher. This time, we decided to take whole classes, nearly 60 students, with the idea that we may be able to reach kids who might not normally take advantage of a Get Connected opportunity. Please welcome three students who I met and developed a mentoring relationship with following that event. Chris Carter, now a freshman business and finance major at Malone University, and Marcellus Bertram and Isaiah Smith, both seniors in the Project Lead the Way, which is a pre-engineering program at Timken High School. But I wasn't the only one seeing the potential for mentoring. So were two Diebold employees, Elizabeth Galloway and Elsa Cave, both of whom had developed connections with Marcellus. Elizabeth couldn't be here tonight, but please welcome to our panel Elsa Cave from Diebold. So we spent the last year really developing these mentoring relationships and understanding how they could work. And again, we learned a lot. So on October 8th of this year, we took another set of classes, another set of juniors, another 50-plus students to another Diebold Get Connected event. But this year, through Elizabeth and Elsa's efforts, we had nearly 30 Diebold employees volunteer to develop mentoring relationships with students who attend to Get Connected. So they're actually volunteering to have relationships with students that will last throughout the whole year, bring them back for lunch, exchange emails with them, and start being involved in these students' lives. So we're going to pilot that program, we're going to nurture it, and we're going to see how that goes. So I'd like to welcome our final panelists who participated in this year's Diebold Get Connected event. Emily Reinhart, a junior from Perry High School who's in the Criminal Justice and Public Safety program that's housed here at Timken High School. And Alex Cox, a junior in the Project Lead the Way program at Timken. So as our panelists take their seats, I'm going to invite Lisa and Dartanyon and Leroy to join them. And I would like to welcome our moderator to the stage. So please welcome Ms. Sherita Gaucher, reporter and columnist from The Repository.
Good evening. Thank you all for coming. I appreciate you being here tonight, especially with this weather. I'd like to thank the folks at United Way for inviting me to participate, particularly my friend Bill Burgess. I'm just curious, how many wrestlers are there in the audience? Probably how many athletes? A few?
I don't see that many hands. There's a few more. There they are.
So that's good to know. We're going to have a conversation with our panelists and our guest speakers here, as you know, and let's just get right into it. First, I'd like to start with Lisa, Dartanyon, and Leroy. First of all, thank you for your sharing your amazing story. I write stories for a living, and this was just one I will never forget, so thank you for bringing that to our community. Lisa, tell me how your relationship with Dartanyon and Leroy has impacted you personally. How are you different from the person who first heard about this story compared to today?
Well, I think first and foremost is what I alluded to toward the end of our presentation, which is how I used to believe that people could overcome difficult circumstances with determination alone. And I now am convinced that that's not true. I have a deeper understanding of poverty, of how it evolves, of how someone is born into it. For example, I just think the path is laid very early in youth, and it's not a choice in most cases. For instance, I've gotten to know Leroy's brother lately, who is he's about 27 years old, and he endured quite a lot of trauma himself. He rescued Leroy from the tracks the day that he was hit. And if you were just to judge his book by the cover, you would say, oh, he's 27, he's unemployed, he's a drug addict, he's got a kid, like, wow, what a loser. But now I know that's absolutely not true. Now I know he had severe trauma in his childhood. Now I know his mother abandoned him. Now I know that he was forced to sell drugs to support the house. Now I know that when he turned 18, his mother, who had bad credit, put the utility bills in his name to keep the lights on, and nobody paid the bills. So now he has thousands of dollars in debt. So that's a specific example to say that now when I meet someone who's on hard times, I really want to take the time to get to know how that happened and how I can help untangle those issues.
You've been kind of called an honorary mother, sister, to the young men here. How has it impacted your relationship, your parenting with your actual children?
Well, quite intimately, actually. When I was filming on Leroy's childhood street in Akron, Laird Street, it was the middle of the day, but I needed a police escort to film there. And, you know, it was a difficult neighborhood, and there were kids who should have been in school that were wandering along the streets, and I remember standing there, and I silently prayed, Lord, I wish I could just take one kid off of Laird Street before they have to struggle like this. And I went home, and adoption is an issue that had always been very dear to my heart, and I talked to my husband about it, and we applied to adopt here in Cleveland. And so in November of 2009, just a few months after our first story aired, we adopted our son from Cleveland. He was born there to a struggling mother who did an extremely heroic thing in wanting to give her son a better life. So I have an African American son who thinks that they are his big brothers, and it is just the family that I've always wanted and never knew to dream of.
Let's bring the young men in as well. How are you different? I know it's a broad question, but has your relationship with Lisa made you more trusting, more optimistic? Who wants to?
Go ahead.
Okay. Before, I was an extreme pessimist. I just looked at everything like, that's never going to happen, whatever. It's never going to happen, so it's not for me. But now I'm more of a realist. Like, I look at it in many different ways. How is this going to help me? How is this going to help everybody else in this situation? So, like, before I came here, it's like, Lisa asked me, do you want to do this? I'm like, oh, it's going to help people. It's not just helping me. It's helping everyone else. So why not? Okay. So it's just, it changed my outlook on how I view everything.
Thank you.
Never mind the fact that I can function like a normal adult now. I've changed in so many ways. I figured out what I wanted to do in life early on just by Lisa being a part of my life, because it opened up so many doors and opportunities for me. I look for any way or any opportunity that I can to help people, whether it's just providing some advice, doing a closing drive, a food drive, anything that would benefit the lives of others the way Lisa's done for us. I'm grateful for every day that I have, and I'm grateful for every bad day I had as well, because I've learned that I had a story. Before, I thought everything that's happened to me was all for no reason, because God hated me or I was just unlucky, had a bad hand. But now I see it as something that's benefited me, and wouldn't say lucky to have gone through what I've gone through, but I'm glad I did, because now I can relate more with people who've been in a situation and who are lost and who don't know where to go and who are still struggling. I can provide advice or give some sort of guidance to those who still struggle with everyday questions like why, what's next, and then is there anyone else struggling like I am?
Thank you. Thank you. Let's bring the students in conversation here. You all participated in a Get Connected program. Can you tell the audience how the experience of having a one-on-one conversation with professionals in the community benefited you? And who'd like to start?
Well, I just recently went to Diebold with my class. And when I was going there, I was really nervous because we had attended a few seminars before, and they were telling us, you know, it's a really good way to start a relationship with somebody if you share something personal about yourself. And I was really scared I was going to get there and say something wrong, and they were just going to look at me like I'm this stupid high school kid. And when I got there, my mentor was Beth Galloway, and she talked to me like I was just another person that she worked with. And that was a really big confidence booster for me, because, oh, I can actually have a conversation with this lady and it'll possibly take me somewhere amazing. So that was really good that they talked to you like you were one of them and not just some high schooler that was coming in for a day.
Anybody else?
For me, it was kind of the same thing. I went there thinking I'm just going to be a field trip, and when we went to the one-on-one, she talked to me in a way that I felt like she was on my level. She told me how she started in the mailroom, went back, got her degree. For me, it was like kind of gave me hope that I can make it in a way.
Last year, we took the same field trip, and the one-on-one experience kind of gives you, it gives you an experience. Because like you're going in the interview, obviously you're on one-on-one with the boss. And it kind of gives you, you want to be strong, you want to sound confident, give yourself off in a good way, let them know who you are, and let them know what you're bringing to the table.
It benefited me by, instead of being perceived as such a child, these professionals really looked at me as if I'm another adult. And they respect me like adult, they talk to me like adult, and they gave me their situation on how they got where they were and how I could do better for myself, like in goals, how I could even reach where I want to go.
Thank you. Tonight's about the value of mentorship. How has having a mentor impacted the students, you students?
For me, having a mentor is like everything, because in my life, like I never lived with my mom or my dad for a long time, or I moved with my granddad or something like that. And even though they was there, like they didn't know much about like college and transcripts and stuff like that, so he would never like try to help me with stuff like that. So I was basically on my own. And then when I met Miss Lori, she helped me do all that. She actually helped me get into college. She helped me do a lot of things. So for her, having a mentor impacted me in a huge way, because it's actually making me become the man I am today.
So it really changed your life?
Yeah, basically.
Anybody else?
For me, it was probably have to say just changed my whole outlook on what I could become and how my family perceived me as. Coming from a family where we argue a lot, we really don't get along. And the opportunities I've been given, my family's starting to see that one of us is trying to make it, and it's amazing how it feels to be the one that's trying to make it.
Mm-hmm. So did having a mentor change your goals, or did it give you goals? Did some of you not even have goals before you got into this program?
It made me sort of feel like my goals were realistic in a way.
Okay. Anyone else?
For me, I knew where I wanted to go. I kind of didn't know how I wanted to get there. I didn't know how to get there because, you know, you have to deal with ACT, FAFSA, and for most high school students and where we live from, your parents don't know that. Or if they do, they're just now learning that. And for Miss Lori, for us, she helps us with that. She helps us. Right now, we're helping with the FAFSA, ACT. And I believe having a mentor is a great thing to have because it allows you to see the aspects of life. Allowed for us, well, me and Marcellus, I believe this past summer helped us grow into a young man. We're not men yet, you know, but it's helping to see the aspects of it. It's letting us see the responsibilities we have to carry and what we need to do to be a young adult.
Thank you. Let's go back to our, somebody else. Anybody else? Go ahead.
Mentoring, like the people inside our lives, they just added another piece to my puzzle that was already there. I had my family, I had my friends, went to a great school, Timken High, and it was just like another piece that just added to the molding of me and, like the rest of them said, becoming the person that I am today. And it was just like another benefit, like another plus up to where I want to be at. So, yeah.
Let's go back to our guest speakers. When you first started working together, the three of you, and started establishing and working towards some goals, how difficult was that? River?
Initially, I think it was like speaking two different languages. Mm. You know, I'm a type A personality, which I'm sure you'd never guess. And I thought I could just sort of email them a blueprint for success for a week or a semester, and they would get open it and read it and follow it, and that would just be how it would go. I'm a person who can accomplish 46 things in a day, so if I would email them and be like, okay, or I'd call them and say, okay, today you need to call about your phone bill, finish your English paper, make that dentist appointment, call customer service, work out your budget for the month, and like somewhere around the second instruction, they would have zoned out. And it took me quite a while to realize this. And what I needed to learn was how to break the goals down into achievable parts. Like, okay, what's the one thing we need to get due today? And then when that was done, I really tried to praise them for that so that they would gain confidence, so that they would want to do it again. Because when you grow up with observing the sort of the lack of productivity habits that they missed out on, doing the mundane things of life are not what they wanted to be doing in a day. They didn't want to be following up on bills or paying bills or, you know, registering for class, whatever it was, it didn't seem as exciting as playing video games and hanging out with their friends. So they had to learn just how to feel successful in being productive, and that was a journey that it took some time. But to their credit, they were extremely humble, extremely gracious to my 50 phone calls a day, and that's why I love them.
Fellas, you wanna?
Oh boy, did it take some time. after graduating high school, like it was tough because we didn't have these skills, and yes, she was down our throat. To-do lists, calls, when are you getting this done? You need to get this done, you gotta get this done, this has to be done, you gotta get this done. There were some points I was just like, you know, no words, just frustration, just being exhibited in noises. But after a while, I started feeling good about what I was doing. I started feeling that what I was doing was beneficial. It was breaking the normal for me. It was like the slide Lisa showed earlier. My comfort zone was here. Here's was the budgeting, the papers, the calls, the to-do lists, all that was here. I didn't want to go near that. I wanted to go over here. I didn't know it was over here, but it seemed better than this. I didn't want any part of this at first. But as I matured, as I grew older, I realized that doing things that are uncomfortable for you, that you don't want to do, are usually the things that you should probably be doing. And I've also learned that if anything in life doesn't suck at least a little bit, it's probably not worth doing.
Yeah, she did hound us. Like, it was, I'd go radio silent here and there. Like, I just leave my phone in one place and lose it. And it'd be like for a week or so. And she'd send me like text messages, and then, you know, one day she'll call and I'll answer, and she's like, oh, did you read that that text message I sent you or that email? I'm like, no, I didn't even know that was there. And then I look at it after we get done on the phone, and I'm like, oh, so you asked me a question in that email, so I got an answer for it. But it's like, you know, I didn't want to do it right then and there at first. But now it's like I kind of multitask because I still want to play my game. So, like, she'll tell me I have to call the doctor, and I'm like, okay.
I'm just going to. All right, so. Oh, you need my driver's license number? All right, hold on. Let me go get it. It's sitting right here. All right, I got to go get it. Get to a safe spot. Save.
All right, my driver's license number is DO7. Yeah. So, you know, I learned to multitask when I'm doing something if I know that the text is there and I'm not radio silent. So.
And important part of mentoring is having, is just understanding that that in the beginning dysfunction was their normal, you know, and so they weren't going to gravitate towards the blueprints for what I thought they needed for their success, and it took a lot of time before productivity, before accomplishment felt normal and was desirable to them. And I think in mentoring relationships, it can be easy in the beginning to be like, well, this just isn't working. But there's, you need to get through the why it's not working.
Yeah. And everybody's different. Like, the thing that she does for Dartanyon, like, I'm pretty sure she doesn't do the same thing because I don't react to it. Just because I've lived in a hard, like I said, when my mom was home, she was always yelling. So it was like that hard feeling. And she doesn't go, you have to, or you gotta do this. No, she goes, you know what you should do? You should take care of this today. Like, she encourages instead of telling me it's a necessity. Instead of hounding me about it, she'll suggest it. And I think the mic just cut out again. But I'm loud enough.
Leaving them absent of choice also helps. Or making someone realize that if you want to succeed, you have to do this. For me, it's if you want to go back to Cleveland and sit on your sister's couch and live there, then you can do this. I didn't want to go back on my sister's couch. I didn't want to go back to Cleveland. I didn't even want to entertain the thought of going back to Cleveland. Because buying that plane ticket would be the longest, like, 3 seconds of my life. Like 3 hours of buying a plane ticket back to Cleveland, where I'd start at square one, have nothing going for me here. So I took the latter of the options, because before, the choices weren't put out in front of me black and white, that if you don't do this, you won't get here. And if you make these choices, you'll end up back here. When that was placed in front of me, it made me really taken to thought, okay, well, if I make this appointment or do this assignment, I'll do this. It's happened. I'll get cookies, cake, and ice cream. If I don't, I'll go back to Cleveland. That's what I do in every situation now. If I don't do something that Lisa tells me to do, I'll go back to Cleveland. I don't want to go back to Cleveland.
That kind of segues into our next question for the students. What do you think is your responsibility as being part of a mentoring relationship?
For me, I think our responsibility is the same as the mentor responsibility. They're supposed to mentor us on how to become people in the workforce and people that function in the business world or whatever field we want to get into, and we are supposed to help mentor them to become people that understand kids like us, or to understand the way that we act, the way that we work, like, because every kid works differently. So with mentoring, our mentors have to treat each of us differently, because mentors, they don't just treat with one of us, they do with all of us. As Miss Lori, my mentor, she has about 5 kids that she mentors. And she treats all of us differently, because that's how we all react differently. Like Leroy was saying, with him and Dartanyon and Lisa, she doesn't do the same thing for both of them because they don't react the same.
Anybody else?
I think a big part that we have is trust. Because without trust within our mentors, you probably won't be able to form the relationship. And without the relationship, you won't have, you know, opportunities open up. You won't have chances come to you that you can take advantage of. I feel as us as mentees, the huge part of us is to have is to form trust.
For me, it is a little bit of, I feel like we shouldn't do anything to mess up our mentor's name, or our mentor shouldn't do anything to mess up our name, because they put their name out there for a lot for us to get us opportunities like this right here, as you see. And off of trust, it's so much trust. Like, I remember having a dinner where we were all sitting there and the thing of whoopings came up. And Miss Lori was sitting there. She was like,
in awe while we're all just sitting there talking about these whoopings that we all got. That they were horrible, but we're all like, yeah, they helped us, because if we didn't get them, we wouldn't be seeing with you right now.
Elsa, you've been involved in Big Brothers and Big Sisters and are helping to coordinate the D-Bowl volunteer mentors. Explain how you're hoping to see this program work and the early results you've seen.
Well, I think the first year we had the program, last year, I don't know that we really knew what to expect. And Marcellus and Isaiah, you can probably attest to that. We thought it was like a field trip. The students were coming to D-Bold and we were going to show them around, and that was it. But because of some of the success stories we had, the first year we decided to really try to focus on the mentoring part of the program this year. So we did that by purposefully seeking out people in our company that were interested in forming a relationship, not just giving a tour, but actually keeping connected with the students after the event was done. We also wanted to make sure we prepared both sides better in advance so they knew what to expect. Beth Galloway and I came to the school one day and we met with the students and shared with them what was going to take place during the event, let them know that the people they were going to meet with wanted to meet with them, and that they should never feel like they're bothering us or that that we don't want to be a part of the process. So I think it went a long way to help them be prepared. We also leaned on Dawn Campanelli from Junior Achievement, and she spent some time with the students getting them ready for that professional interaction. And the result, I think, was amazing. The students were more engaged this year. The D-Bold associates were more engaged. There's a lot of great questions, interactions, exchanging business cards, and follow-up. I think the follow-up was much better this year. And actually had employees coming to me after the event and thanking me for asking them to be a part of the event, because they were so excited to see the level of engagement from these students and the promise that there could be more to come. So I think now the challenge is really to keep that momentum going and to find those follow-up opportunities and to make sure we continue to foster the relationship. But the early successes so far have just been a great buzz at D-Bold, and I think amongst the students as well. A lot of them are up here tonight.
What value do you think it brings to a company to be involved in mentoring?
Well, I think from an organization's perspective, the opportunity to understand what the students are learning and look for the synergies with the types of skills we would look for from new hires. A great example is Mr. Weaver's Project Lead the Way curriculum. A lot of the assignments that he's giving to these students use the same tools and techniques that we use at D-Bold to design and build prototypes in our facility in North Canton. So there's a lot of synergy there, and I think it's encouraging for us to see that the students are learning these skills. It's encouraging for the students. You know, how many times have students said, why do I have to learn this? I'm never going to use this again. But that's not the case. They will. And, you know, I think also it gives our associates an opportunity to be engaged in the community and form some relationships with students. And it fits within their busy schedules. And, you know, from an organization standpoint, it supports our corporate social responsibility efforts that we're trying to drive as well.
Thank you. And I would just add to that, you know, through my involvement with the Canton Chamber, I've realized how much our businesses here need a good pipeline of talent to come through. And that was really one of the win-wins that I saw in creating this program, was this opportunity. You know, they have these really smart, wonderful kids here that want to stay in this community, just need a little bit of help and support to be able to achieve the goals that they want to set. So to me, it's definitely a win-win situation for both the businesses and the students.
Well, this next question is for you and for Lisa. The idea of mentoring a teenager or a younger person can be intimidating to a lot of people. Where did you find the courage to do it?
You know, I received quite a lot of emails from people who would say things like, gosh, I wish I could do something amazing like you did. And I would write back and be like, I have great news, you can, because I am a pretty average person.
And of course you see that, and everyone looks heroic if you put that kind of music behind them and shoot them with broadcast cameras. But if you saw me at home in my bathroom with my two toddlers, you'd be like, oh, she's just like me. And I would say that if you find the mission slightly daunting, then you're operating from a place of realism and you're probably the right person for the job. Because if you're going into it looking for a happy Hollywood ending, I mean, you might get it, but there's going to be some bumps along the way. It can be delicate, but that's what makes it meaningful. And there's certainly been plenty of issues that we have faced in the last 5 years that I didn't have all the answers to. You don't have to have all the answers before you begin. I mean, we dealt with teenage pregnancy and failing grades and PTSD and disability issues, and there's been many moments where I've said to Leroy and Dartanyon, you know, I'm not sure what we do here, but let's walk through this mess together and figure it out. And I'm also not the only person who has come alongside them to support them. We've had many other people that we've been able to turn to for help, their coaches, tutors, benefactors, people that we've absorbed into our carry-on family. We call it the carry-entourage. And it's just a really special group of people. So I would say if you're a little bit intimidated, then I think that's good. I think you're the right person for the job. Take the leap.
I mean, for me, you know, I didn't actually go into this saying, I'm going to become a mentor. It just, as I said, you know, kind of evolved. Really, for all of them, it evolved through email conversations. I have a mentoring email address that I gave the students when we started to get connected just to try to give them an opportunity to practice doing those, you know, thank yous and reaching out to people before they actually went into the business environment. And these were the students that I happened to hear from. As Lisa said, you know, we have an amazing community in terms of a framework for support. And I think we really could, I wouldn't have been as comfortable bringing this to this community if we didn't have this amazing framework already in place. So with what 211 has, with what United Way has, with the resources that are out here through these agencies, pretty much everything that we've run across that I've been able to either go to 211 for, or go to the schools for, or go to the care teams for, to be able to help and support. And there's groups like the Fatherhood Coalition. I've done a really good job this year of really broadening my own support network, because I don't have all the answers. And I know that there are other people out there that do. And the other thing I know that is just them giving them the opportunity to learn about themselves a little bit, become a little bit more self-aware, practice the communication and skills it takes to actually find help and support from a financial aid counselor or an advisor or things like that is good for them. So, you know, a lot of times, like Lisa said, I'll say, I don't really know the answer. I'm going to help you find the answer, or let's figure out who does.
Thank you. To the students, how do your families feel about you being involved in a mentoring relationship? Were there some that weren't sure what was going on, or have you gotten a lot of support? What's been the response?
My family supports me getting mentored, because sometimes they can't give the advice that they can. So I met with a guy named Patrick Ryan, and he was really smart in math and science and things that you need to be to work with engineers. And sometimes my parents just didn't have those answers, so he really helped me out with advice for school and things of that nature. He was the one that told me that I needed to talk to my professor, since I'm taking college pre-calculus, about how maybe he could even explain things differently to me so I understand them better. And I seen a drastic improvement in my grade. So my family really supports everything that this program is doing. And it's just wonderful.
Thank you. Anybody else?
I really think that when I first started out with the whole mentoring program, and I don't think my parents actually knew really what it was at first. And I know that I told my mom I was going to Diebold, and she's like, hey, I worked at Diebold, so that's pretty cool. And she's a computer programmer. That's not really what I want to do. I want to go into the public safety field. And I think that they're really supportive now that they see what it could possibly do for me, because especially with the ACT and the SAT, I haven't taken it yet. I'm a junior. So Miss Lori's really helping me figure out what I need to do to take that and get good grades on that, and really help me to figure out what path I need to take to get where I want to be.
Okay, for me, my family, at first, they was kind of sketchy, like, okay, you're an 18-year-old kid, this lady, she's about 50-some years, or she's about 49, 50 years old. They're like, what's going on? Something gotta be going on. I'm like, no, it's not like that. No, that's what's going on. Those was definitely the first questions my mom and my dad asked. But once they got to know Miss Lori and they met her, they're like, oh, this is for real. This is serious. And then they became very supportive and like, oh, this is great. Then my dad leaned on the fact that he said, oh, I had a mentor. She's like my mom now. And he still has a relationship with her today. My mom, she jumped on board. So, and from there, everything was good.
Glad to hear that.
That hits close to home.
I guess I can ask the same question to the mentors. It's a big commitment to you know, do this. What do your families think of it?
I'm blessed with the world's most supportive husband. I mean, he shares a world view. He shares my world view that we are here to give. And that we are here for the purpose of loving one another and of serving one another. And so even though he's not here on stage with me tonight, he loves Leroy and Dartanyon. He considers them our family. He's constantly asking how they are and what they're doing, and when he gets the chance, he loves hanging out with them. So I'm incredibly blessed in that sense. We share that worldview and the desire to give.
Thank you.
I mean, I think my husband's here in the audience. I think he would say at the beginning he thought it was a little weird, probably like Chris's parents were. What's going on here? Because these relationships just kind of evolved, and what happened was, you know, we start learning about each other, right, and say, oh, I could probably help you with that. And then the more you help, the more you find ways to offer opportunities, and then the more you offer opportunities, the more you get to know them better, and the more you start caring for them, and that's just kind of how those relationships evolved. You know, it really was probably 4 months, I think, after I first heard from Chris that I said, you know, we really want to try this mentoring. Do you want to be in a mentoring relationship? Like, let's just be official and let's see what this will work. We didn't make it Facebook official. My husband's actually met all the kids, and now he asked me about them, and he's so excited when he hears things that they're doing that are going well. You know, he talks to Chris about football and real excited when he hears how these guys are doing so well with public speaking, and is very supportive and thinks that it's actually a great thing for businesses. And my boys feel the same way. My boys know all the kids, and they're very, very supportive. So my mom is here too, and she's always sending things over for them and things like that. So, yeah, they're very supportive.
Thank you.
So really, my experience mentoring on a professional level is kind of new. So so far everybody that I've told about it has been very supportive, maybe a bit inquisitive, but I did mentor through Big Brothers Big Sisters for 5-6 years, and that was more of a community-based mentoring program. But it was amazing how family and loved ones would ask about my little and how she was doing, and even now that she's grown and she's aged out, if you will, of the program, they still ask and they still want to know how she's doing. So they do become a part of your life.
Final question. There are probably about 600 people here tonight, maybe, hopefully. There may be some people who might be interested in mentoring. What would any of you say to encourage them to give it a try?
Do it now. Like, if you got the chance, do it. Like, no, really, like, you should do it. Like, even if you don't feel comfortable, like, you should try it. Like, you can always, like, opt out. Like, they're not gonna, like, make you, like, no, you gotta do this. Like, it's not something you have to do. It's a choice. But I think I can speak for all when I say you should really do it, because 9 times out of 10, it's gonna be all positive and it's gonna help you.
I think that I would say that you should definitely do it, because even if there's not a program like when they took us to Diebold, I think that reaching out to someone in the community that you could possibly help and help in their life by giving your experience, I think it's a great thing, because at Perry, we don't really get opportunities like this. I mean, they're there, but because you have to seek them out on your own, and not many people do that, the counselors can't even really help you because they don't know a lot about it themselves. And I think that if you can introduce yourself to someone and help them in any way possible, it's a great thing.
Do it! Nah, just think about it this way. I'm an extreme introvert, and on top of that, I'm claustrophobic, but I'm here.
It's hard being afraid of Santa Claus.
Shut up. I'm not afraid of Santa Claus.
Well, we thank you all for your cooperation and participation, and it's been a really good night. One more person? One more?
If you want to see someone grow, I encourage it a lot because about a year ago after the program went, I emailed Miss Elizabeth and got all this. Everyone was asking me, oh, you need to come speak in front of this class and do all this, and I would always say no. I'm making people go that didn't even have any insight on what happened, and now I'm in front of 600 plus people talking, and it's crazy.
Join me. Thank you.
While our panelists get the chairs moved out of the way, I hope this discussion's given you some better insight into the power of mentoring. Like Lisa, I didn't start Get Connected expecting to develop these amazing relationships with these incredible kids, but that's what happened. I will say, though, that seeing that story on ESPN gave me permission to do what was already in my heart, and that's why I wanted to bring it here to you. So now it is my pleasure to introduce United Way. Oh, I'm sorry. Sorry. It'll be a minute. So where do we go from here? There's many people in our community that are already doing what's in their hearts with little fanfare or recognition. Teachers, coaches, parents, neighbors, coworkers, who subtly identify a need and quietly do what they can to help. But if you feel a call to do more, there are many ways you can help. You can contact United Way to discuss holding a Get Connected program in your business or organization. We've also given you a booklet of mentoring programs in our community that allow you to get involved in whatever capacity fits your life. And you'll find many other volunteer opportunities on United Way's Volunteer Resource Center at uwstark.org. So tomorrow we're going to have approximately 500 kids here from area school districts. So if anybody ever decides they want to do two huge events in 2 days, let me just tell you, don't do that. But anyway, we're having 500 kids come tomorrow from the different school districts, coming to hear our speakers again give a presentation called Let Your Story Be Told. And our goal is to teach these students that it doesn't matter where you live or how much money you have or you don't have. It doesn't matter your age. It doesn't matter your status. If you believe in yourself and your story, if you surround yourself with people who believe in you, if you trust opportunity enough to walk through the door when it's knocking, then you're taking the first steps to a successful life. As we heard from our panel, mentoring requires a partnership between a caring mentor and a willing mentee. So Stark County's fortunate. If you don't think so, just look around. We've got people sitting here on a Thursday night where it's pretty cold outside, looking for more ways to get involved, to create opportunities to help students and community members live to their full potential. Thank you. So now I'd like to invite, you guys don't know, but we're making history tonight because Lisa, Dartanyon, and Leroy have never spoken to an audience this loud. So they'd like to actually, Lisa would like to share a few closing comments about what we're trying to do in our community.
No, after after Leroy's and D'Artagnan's stories aired in 2009, thousands of people reached out to help them specifically. But after their story aired in 2013, the reaction was also overwhelming in the best sense of the word, but it felt different. And it felt different because people were no longer reaching out to just help them, but they were writing to tell me things like a man in Stamford, Connecticut, who said, every day for 20 years I have driven by that home for disadvantaged boys, and today I stopped and I picked up the application.
I received emails from addicts who said, "Today's the day I called and went to rehab. If they can do it, so can I." I heard from a family in New York City who said, "You know, we have been operating from a position of strength and wholeness, and it's about time we give back. We signed up to be foster parents." A family on my street met Dartanyon one summer, and they immediately signed up to be foster parents, and they now have a 9-year-old boy in addition to the 4 children of their own. And so what we were seeing is that the past that they saw as waste, as brokenness, as was now being used, those broken pieces were being used to inspire other people, and that was the power of their message. And the thing I learned through that process is that there was a lot of people out there who wanted to help. They weren't always sure how, but they knew that they wanted to, and I have a feeling that's why a lot of you have come here tonight as well. And the United Way is giving you avenues to match your skills with your callings. And if you feel that pull on your heart, answer it tonight. Thank you.
And now I would like to invite Stacy Kyle, who with husband Rich is chairing this year's United Way annual campaign, to the podium.
I think we've seen tonight the impact that just one caring person can make. When my husband Rich and I were approached to chair the United Way campaign of Stark County, I really wasn't sure what to expect, kind of like entering a mentor relationship. But now I've been to rallies, events, the Day of Caring. I've served on the board, and I'm a true believer in what United Way does. We've heard incredible stories like this and many others. The United Way affects change in lives and makes an enormous impact in the lives, especially of youth in our community. I have witnessed that great things can happen when we live united. As Lori mentioned, there are many ways to bring about change. In your brochure tonight, you were given a special pledge form that will help you stay part of this conversation and show your support for the United Way if you feel so inclined. I want to congratulate Lori and the Women's Leadership Council for their 10-year anniversary. I anticipate the next 10 years are going to be amazing for them. Thank you all for being a part of this special evening, and thank you all for coming and sharing your story. It was wonderful and inspiring. I know it's late, so if you just hang on for one couple minutes, we have a closing presentation, and drive home safely. Thank you for coming.
You and me were always with each other. Before we knew, the other was ever there. You and me, we belong together, just like a breath meets the air. I told you if you called, I would come running across the highs and lows and the in-between. You and me, we've got two minds to think as one, and our hearts march to the same beat. They say everything, it happens for a reason. You can be flawed enough, but perfect for a person. Someone who will be there for you when you fall apart, guiding your direction when you're riding through the dark. Same light, desperate for a cure to this disease. Well, some days are better than others, but I fear no thing as long as you're with me. They say everything, it happens for a reason. You can be thought enough, someone who apart. Guiding your direction when you're riding through the dark.